the mature Chopin Polonaise. As we said, it took him a longer time to develop his genius in this form, the form that he incarnated his nationalism and the homeland which he was never to see again. It took him till 1836 to publish the fine Polonaise in C-sharp minor along with the E-flat minor. And we heard the E-flat minor in a performance by Rubinstein, and we then moved to the military Polonaise in a performance by Horowitz. We'd like to go back to the E-flat minor and hear a performance, although the sound being quite awful, the pianism vast, and that is Josef Hoffman playing the so-called Siberian Polonaise. Josef Hoffman and all the iridescent pathos of that work and desperation are put forth in a performance that to me is magnificent. It's a work heavy with oppression. I wouldn't want to hear it more than twice in a row. Now to more bracing air in the military Polonaise, again the famous A major, the name, not Chopin's own. He probably composed this at Mallorca during the desperate 6 weeks he was living there with George Sand and her children. At least he was finishing it up there. We heard last night Vladimir Horowitz play it. And we have another performance by Hoffman. Here's the A major Polonaise. Polonaise in A major, Josef Hoffman, pianist. brilliantly chivalrous work. The companion piece in C minor is a greater work, in my opinion. It was composed in 1838, along with the A major. As Anton Rubinstein said, the A major was the glory of Poland. The C minor, opus 40, number 2, the tragedy of Poland. A new pianist, Alfred Brendel. Thank you. a deeply felt performance of the C minor Polonaise by Alfred Brendel. It's a work seldom performed. Can anything be more impressive than that marvelous opening? And the trio in A flat has some strange and lovely harmonies. There's loftiness of spirit in this work. It's marvelous creation. Let's hear the Polish-born pianist in the same work, Małcużyński.
Thank you.
That was Witold Małcużyński, a pupil of the immortal Paderewski. And I think Chopin would have been pleased to know that Paderewski became president of Poland, though Poland did not long remain free. Paderewski, the great pianist, patriot, is buried in Arlington National Cemetery at the command of President Roosevelt. And his heart is in the United States waiting to go back to a free Poland. There's a Polish tradition that the heart goes back to the homeland. Chopin's heart is buried in Poland, and his remains are in Paris. And I'm sorry that we do not have a Paderewski performance of the Polonaise. We will return to these mighty compositions of nationalism ennobled by art very shortly. Minor. Not as well known as the so-called heroic Polonaise to follow, yet one of Chopin's greatest works. It's an awe-inspiring work. James Huneker writes, "What can one say of the tremendous F-sharp minor Polonaise? It is barbaric, it is perhaps pathologic, and of it, Liszt has said most eloquent things. It is for him a dream poem, the lurid hour that precedes a hurricane, with a convulsive shudder at the close. The opening is very impressive, the nerve pulp being harassed by the gradually swelling prelude. There is defiant power in the first theme, and the constant reference to it betrays the composer's exasperated mental condition. This tendency to return upon himself, a tormenting introspection, certainly signifies a grave state. But consider the musical weight of the work, the recklessly bold outpourings of a mind almost distraught. There is no greater test for the poet pianist than the F-sharp minor Polonaise. It is profoundly ironical. What else means the introduction of that lovely mazurka, a flower between two abysses? This strange dance is ushered in by two of the most enigmatic pages of Chopin. The A major intermezzo, with its booming cannons and reverberating overtones, is not easily defensible on the score of form. Yet it unmistakably fits in the picture. The return of the tempest is not long delayed. It bursts, wanes, and with the coda comes sad yearnings. Then the savage drama passes tremblingly into the night after fluid and wavering affirmations, a roar in F-sharp, and finally a silence that marks the cessation of an agitating nightmare. No saber dance, this, but a confession from the dark depths of a self-tortured soul." James Huneker's elaborate analysis of the F-sharp minor Polonaise. And within this work, where he speaks of a flower between two abysses, is a mazurka. Let's have a performance by Vladimir Horowitz.
Thank you.
Horowitz exhibits just the kind of playing necessary for this gigantic work. That was the F-sharp minor Polonaise. It was never played often, and it's still not. And yet it's one of the great works by Chopin, and again proves, or should destroy, the image of Chopin, the drawing room composer. A mighty spirit, and the strangeness of that work always interests me. It'd be hard to follow that performance with another one, but on our next program I would like to hear that Polonaise again. Nor do we have time, I see. However, we're going to conclude with the legendary performance, and it truly is, of the Polonaise in A-flat, the most famous of them all, and probably the culminating point in his writing in this form. It's so perfect. Josef Lhévinne is the pianist, and it was a specialty of his, and we shall hear it now. There is imaginative splendor in this thrilling work, with its thunder of horses' hooves and fierce challengings. What fire, what sword thrusts and smoke and clash of mortal conflict. Here is no psychical presentation, but an objective picture of battle, of concrete contours, and with a cleaving brilliancy that excites the blood to boiling pitch. None but the heroes of the keyboard may grasp its dense chordal masses. And in Lhévinne's performance, we heard one of the heroes of the keyboard. Join me on our next program when we continue on the Polonaises. We will go back and hear the F-sharp minor, other performances of the famous A-flat, conclude with the, to me, the greatest of the Polonaises, the Fantasy Polonaise. And I thank you for listening.